weekly satsang program. We are continuing our discussion of the Bhagavad Gita. In fact, we are concluding our discussion of the Bhagavad Gita today. This was a journey that was started practically 10 years back. We restarted this program in 2010, October 2010, at the home of our Remuna Prabhu. At his behest, we started this program, restarted this program. And I think around February, March of 2011 was when we started the Bhagavad Gita. We started with the introduction, then verse by verse we started. So it's been a long journey, 10 years. And I congratulate all of you who have been on any part of this journey, whether you've been there from the beginning or you've come in the very end or you came somewhere in between. It does not matter at what point of the journey you joined. It is like, you're going on a super highway, which is going from, let's say, Mumbai to Delhi. Okay, now someone joined that highway at Mumbai, someone joined it at Thane, someone joined it in Baroda, someone joined it in Kota. It does not matter at what stage you joined. As long as you're on the highway, you will still reach Delhi, right? So that's the beauty of participating in transcendental, satsang, listening to Harikatha. At any stage, if we join the journey, we will still be purified, right? It's a very beautiful thing. So I thank all of you for taking part in this journey and encouraging me and all the devotees who have been part of organizing this satsang for so many years. Thank you very much. So let us just read the translations of these last five verses once more. And then from there, we can go to the discussion. Text 74, Sanjaya said, "Thus I have heard the conversation of two great souls, Krishna and Arjuna. And so wonderful is that message that my hair is standing on end. By the mercy of Vyasa, I have heard these most confidential talks directly from the master of all mysticism, Krishna, who was speaking personally to Arjuna." Text 76, "O King, as I repeatedly recall this wondrous and holy dialogue between Krishna and Arjuna, I take pleasure, being thrilled at every moment. O King, as I remember the wonderful form of Lord Krishna, I am struck with wonder more and more, and I rejoice again and again." And finally, text 78, "Wherever there is Krishna, the master of all mystics, and wherever there is Arjuna, the supreme archer, there will also certainly be opulence, victory, extraordinary power, and morality. That is my opinion." Hare Krishna. So last time, when we were discussing the Gita last week, we came to the final two dialogues between Krishna and Arjuna, where Krishna asks, "Oh Arjuna, my dear Arjuna, I have explained everything to you now. Has your illusion gone away? Your ignorance gone away? Have you understood? Did you hear everything attentively? Have you been freed from ignorance and illusion?" So Arjuna then responds, and there is one response, and it's like very pakka response, and that's where the samvad ends. Arjuna says that, "Nashto moha, my illusion is gone. Smritir labha, my memory has come back. Tvat prasadad mayachuta, by your memory, I have regained my by your mercy, I have regained your memory. Stithosmi gata sandeya, I am now firm and free and fixed in, I am free from all doubt, I am fixed in knowledge. And Karishye Vachanantava, I am prepared to act according to your instructions." And there, if one had any doubt, if anyone had any doubt, if Duryodhan had any doubt, if Drona had any doubt, Karna had any doubt, if Dhritarashtra had any doubt, that maybe Arjuna will not fight. He's bewildered. He is weak. He's become weak. So the weakness that Arjuna spoke about in the second chapter of Gita is all gone. His illusion is all gone. And he says, Karishye vachanam tavan. What is Krishna's vachan? Fight and fight for me. Krishna has told him in so many words, you fight for me, become my devotee, just surrender unto me and don't worry. Any sinful reaction, if at all sinful reaction comes, I will free you from sinful reactions. Don't worry. What a fantastic, you know, assurance Krishna gives him. And therefore, Arjuna replies in kind, saying, yes, sir. Yes, sir. I will do what you are telling me. I will follow your instructions. So now after this, he stops speaking. And then Sanjaya now responds, right? This is in this section from 74 to 78, the last five verses of the Gita. Sanjaya summarizes his feelings, what he feels after hearing, after witnessing this very transcendental and very privileged conversation. It's a privileged conversation. Please understand. This Bhagavad Gita is spoken by, you know, like in today's day and age, there is this phone tapping that happens. You know, people tap the phones of people. They put, you know, microphones in vase, in the TV, in various places where it will not be noticed. And they listen to conversation of important people to get privileged information. It's called privileged information. That means it's a great privilege to hear it. It may be unauthorized, it may be illegal, but to get that information of two very important people speaking is very privileged. So make no mistake about it. This conversation is transcendental because it is being spoken by the Supreme Lord Krishna. Dharmam tu sakshat bhagavat pranitam. It is the Supreme Lord Krishna who establishes dharma through his words, through his actions. He establishes dharma. So no one less than the Supreme Lord himself, who is the source of everything in this world, source of all knowledge, source of all material creation, source of everything. He is explaining directly to Arjuna that, Arjuna, okay, this is what you need to do. So it's a very, very transcendental and a very privileged conversation. And Sanjaya, because he is a disciple of Vyasadeva, Vyasadeva is again a disciple of Narada, who is directly heard from Krishna. So they basically are like kind of god brothers. They are, you know, in the same parampara. So, but yeah, at the same time, he is a direct disciple of Vyasadeva also. So this Sanjaya, after hearing this conversation, he is overwhelmed, right? And he is explaining his feelings of being overwhelmed. He is, because like any person who is having a little bit of humility, he, when he hears something like this, he'll understand, I don't deserve to hear this. I am not qualified to hear this, to speak this, to be any part of this. Because what a conversation between the Supreme Lord, who in the course of the conversation has revealed his opulence. He has spoken his opulences. He has revealed his opulence. He showed his transcendental, you know, this Virat Roop. So, Sanjay is saying, boss, I don't belong here. This is not, I don't have any aukat to, you know, to be part of this. But simply because of the mercy of my spiritual master Vyasadeva, because of his mercy, because of his grace, a person like me had the opportunity to hear this transcendental conversation. So he hears, he glorifies the speaker of the Gita, he glorifies his guru, he glorifies the contents of the Gita, that what impact it has had on him as a person. And then he states his conclusion about the outcome of the war in the final verse, right? So This section is very important because we are that outsider. Hum Arjun nahi hai. We may feel that, oh, you know, we should, like we say, Srila Prabhupada speaks in the Gita, in the introduction itself, he speaks that we must try to listen to Gita in the mood of Arjuna. Right? Like, how was Arjuna listening to Gita? In a surrendered spirit, that Krishna, now you please tell me what I should do. I'm your disciple now. I'm not your friend or anything like that. I'm your disciple. You teach me. You please tell me. Right? So we should listen to that mood. But we should understand we are like Sanjaya. We are not Arjun. We are like Sanjaya, who are koi dur dur tak Krishna Bhagwan se koi sambandh nahi hai, kuch nahi. We have at a transcendental level, at a spiritual level, we have a direct connection with Krishna, but because of forgetfulness, we have forgotten everything. We don't remember anything about Krishna. But then suddenly, because of our Guru's grace, we get connected to the message of the Gita. We hear each word, each syllable that is spoken by the Supreme Lord Krishna. Each word is so precious. He gets to hear that. We also are like that. We're so fortunate. We have no qualifications. Like Sanjaya, we have no qualifications to hear the Gita, what to speak of speaking the Gita. Zero qualification is there. Zero. Zero ka minus negative mein hum log. But simply because of the grace of our Guru, because of the grace and mercy of all the Vaishnavas who have blessed all of us, not just me, all of us, we are all blessed. Therefore, we have had this great fortune of joining this journey of hearing Srimad Bhagavad Gita. That is how we should read it. That is how we should hear it. And that is how we should understand it. This Bhagavad Gita is not an ordinary scripture. Right? So Sanjaya describes the conversation he's just heard as wonderful. Right? He says, let's just go to the translation. Thus I have heard the conversation of two great souls, Krishna and Arjuna, and so wonderful is this message that my hair is standing on end. Right? Earlier, whose hair was standing on end? Arjuna. Out of fear, out of bewilderment, his hair was standing on end. He says, Roma Harshascha Jayate, I am not able to fight, I am finished. And now Sanjaya, out of ecstasy, he has got to see the Supreme Lord Krishna like a, you know, like a telecast, live prasar. Kya bolte isko? Prasaran. Prasaran bolte hai na? I don't know. Live telecast, you know, of this conversation between Arjuna and Krishna. He has heard it. He's very grateful. And his hair is standing on end. These are signs of ecstasy. When a devotee is, you know, in ecstasy of love of Krishna, certain ecstatic symptoms erupt from their body. They are not able to control it. Sanjaya is feeling that way. His hair is standing on it. And it's not that he is feeling that, oh, so great I am, I got to hear. He is in that mood of a devotee that, no, I have no right to hear this, but I got to hear it. I just got to hear it. I am just so grateful. Between these two great people, I got to hear. But I got to hear. And my hair is standing on end. So why is this conversation so wonderful? As Sanjaya, you know, has said, Srila Prabhupada explains in the purport. It is wonderful because such an important conversation between two great souls has never taken place before and will never take place again. Right? So, this is an amazing conversation that is happening between the Supreme Lord himself. Here, there isn't even, you know, the guru of Arjun or the guru of, you know, or some great, you know, sadhu or some great sannyasi or somebody speak. Even the most powerful person in this material creation is not speaking. Who is speaking? Krishna himself, right? So it is a wonderful opportunity. And then who is listening? Arjuna, who at that point of time, by all means of calculation, was the greatest. I mean, if there was a, like in colleges, you have Mr. Mithibai, you have Mr. VJTI, you have Mr. UDCT. That way, if there was a Mr. India, Mr. Universe at that time, it would surely be Arjun. He was the most perfect person, perfect in all sense of the term. He was a perfect son. He was a perfect brother. He was a perfect husband. He was a perfect disciple. He was perfect. The perfect friend of Krishna. He was perfect in every respect. And then he became the perfect disciple also. He left all his Gandhi. He left his power. He left his knowledge of scripture. He left his conceptions of what is right and wrong. He left everything and just put his head down and surrendered the lotus feet of Krishna. That's what makes this conversation so wonderful. And here is one person who is Mr. Perfect, but he acknowledges that I am insignificant. I am useless. I have completely lost it. My Lord, you tell me now what I should do. I am leaving behind all our friendly talks. I am leaving behind all my conceptions of what I should do, Lord, because they are only making me more bewildered. So my Lord, now I will only listen to what you say. Please tell me what to do. Please explain to me. And then once Krishna starts explaining also, this conversation is not like a linear, it's not like a one-way, monologue between Krishna and Arjuna. No. Krishna says something. Arjuna asks a question. Hey, but what about this? What is the difference between this and this? How do I understand this? How do I recognize this? He's not like a foolish guy who just, listens to a monologue and, at the end of it, we'll both achha laga, very nice. No, he's a discriminating, intelligent person who is listening attentively and asking questions to clarify. That's what makes this conversation so transcendent, so wonderful, right? Such a conversation never taken place, will never take again. Then, the second reason why this conversation is wonderful, Srila Prabhupada explains, is because the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, he is speaking about himself and his energies to the living entity. It is wonderful because you can imagine, I can't think of a good enough example, but just a mundane example just comes to my mind. Some of you might have heard about Harry Houdini. Harry Houdini was one of the greatest magicians of the 20th and 19th and 20th century. Now, suppose he comes in front of you, okay, and he explains, to a complete novice, jisko magic ka MB malum nahi hai, usko wo magic ka esoteric concepts ek ek karke samjhayega. I'm sorry, I'm not able to give a good enough example. If I take a great king, who is emperor of the earth, he comes before an ordinary citizen, some farmer, some ordinary villager, some ordinary person like you and me. He comes before us and he very lovingly explains to us, "Acha, you don't know what is political science? I'll explain to you. I'll explain to you what is political science." He explains whole political science. "Acha, you don't know what it means to manage all the four varnas? Okay, I'll explain to you what are the four varnas. Then I will explain to you what are their interactions. Then I will explain to you how the Kshatriyas, they use these Sam Dam Dandabed to control the four Varnas. I'll explain to you." I mean, ekdam prem se ek element usko explain karega to kaisa hoga? This is the best example I can think with my limited mind. But now you imagine the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It is not even one of his incarnations. It is not even one of his Shaktyavesh avatars. It is him, the source of all avatars, himself. He is explaining about himself and about his multifarious, unlimited energies to a living entity, Arjuna, who is his great devotee, right? And this is in itself a wonderful thing that Bhagwan khud apne baare mein bata rahe. Acha, you want to know about me? Okay, ekdam short mein batata hun. Time nahi hai. We are on a backy field. So I'll just very shortly tell you who I am. That, you know, all these energies, whatever you see, is all coming from me only, Arjuna. Whatever this Gandhi, whatever this power you think you have, it's all coming from me. You know, so it's such a loving, very, you know, nice way Krishna is explaining to Arjuna who he is. That's why it is wonderful. So Srila Prabhupada says, and Sanjaya says, if we follow in the footsteps of Arjuna to understand Krishna, right? That what is, who is this Krishna? What are his opulences? Who am I in relation to him? What is my connection with Krishna? If we understand this in footsteps of Arjuna, then our life will be happy and successful. So Sanjaya realizes this, right? Which is why he is saying that my hair is standing on end. That I got to hear the Supreme Personality of Godhead conversation with Supreme Lord and Arjuna. I got to hear that. So he realizes this, and that's why his hair stands on end. Then in text 75, Sanjaya says, by the mercy of Vyasa, I have heard these most confidential talks directly from the master of all mysticism, Krishna, who was speaking personally to Arjuna. So now, Sanjaya said first that, hey, I am grateful I was able to hear this wonderful conversation. And now he is taking a moment to acknowledge that I was not qualified to hear this. It is only by the mercy of my spiritual master, Vyasadeva, my guru's spiritual master, Vyasadeva, by his mercy, I could hear from the master of mysticism, Krishna, right? The source of all mysticism, I heard from him when he was personally speaking to Arjuna, right? So, what is the meaning of mercy? For a moment, if we can stop to just think, right? Why do we say, Guru ki kripa hogi to hoga, Bhagwan ki kripa hogi to hoga. You know, and here also Sanjaya is referring to this kripa, this mercy of, you know, of Arjuna, of Krishna, of his spiritual master, Vyasa. So, kripa basically means, mercy basically means when you get something which you don't deserve. If you think you deserve, then where is the question of mercy? Right? So when a hardened criminal who has been sentenced to death, right, he's been sentenced to death, he has tried all the legal means available to him. He went to the session court, he went to the A court, whatever, family court, he went to the high court, he went to the Supreme Court. And in every court, bang, 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 they are saying no, guilty, 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 sentenced to death. Now he is kind of resigned to his fate, he's going to be sentenced to death. As one last try, he goes to, writes to the president of the country who has the power to forgive if he or she sees the merits of the case. He or she can forgive even above the judiciary, right? So when he is writing to the president, what do you think he will write? Will he write that these judges and all these people are all fools? They're stupid. They don't know their jobs. Sab waste hai wo log. Wo log jante nahi hai ki main kaun hu. I am not at all guilty. I am, in fact, very innocent. You should give me a mercy. You should give me a, you know, you should accept my mercy petition. Do you think he will write like that? How will he write? He will write in the most humble, the most क्या बोलते हैं, वेरी तुच्छ लैंग्वेज दैट सी आई यू नो आई आई हम्बली बेग फॉर मर्सी, प्लीज गिव मी दिस मर्सी, राइट, आई डोंट डिजर्व इट, ओके, आई डोंट डिजर्व इट, आई एम अ बैड पर्सन, बट आई हैव अ फैमिली एंड इफ इफ आई डाई माई फैमिली विल बी ऑन द रोड्स, दिल हैव नो वन टू टेक केयर ऑफ देम, आई बेग फॉर योर मर्सी, please give me a mercy. And then if the president gives him mercy, you know, clemency as they call it, if he gives him, then it is simply mercy. It is not that this person deserved it and therefore he got it. He begged for mercy and he received the mercy. So when we get something from spiritual master, whatever we get, that is Guru's mercy upon us. We can never feel that I deserve it, Baba. Don't you know how many years I've been in devotional life? Kitne 20 saal se main bhakti kar raha hun. I've been chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. I deserve. I'm a great devotee. Moment we think like that, moment we start to think like that, forget saying it. Most devotees will not say this because, you know, they know that immediately everyone will frown upon them. But in your mind, if you're thinking like this, right, that means you don't need mercy. You feel I deserve. Milna hi hai mere ko. But the moment we think like that, we immediately lose all rights to mercy. Mercy ka null band ho jata hai. That tap, you know, like when we speak Hari Katha, when we do some seva in the temple, like we make beautiful garlands, or we sing some kirtan, or we decorate the altar, or we make a beautiful turban for the Lord. All this activity, we may feel it is my expertise, my skills, but this is the mercy of Guru Parampara which is flowing through. Hamari koi aukaat nahi. It is only by the Guru Parampara, which has empowered us, that we are able to do anything, however insignificant. It is by their mercy it has happened, right? So, Sanjaya is acknowledging that we can only understand and experience Krishna simply by the grace of our Guru. There is no other way for this to happen. Yeah. So there is no other way for this to happen. He says, we can experience and understand. Srila Prabhupada says, we can experience and understand Krishna and his instructions of the Gita. We can experience and understand Krishna and his instructions of the Gita only through the transparent via medium of Guru. So this is a very powerful, phrase that Srila Prabhupada has used. I have read this for many years, but mere ko kabhi ye chamka nahi tha ki ye transparent via media kya hai. I don't know, Rimana Prabhu, whether you know you ever maybe you do. I never really got it. Ye kya hota hai transparent via media? Today I got it. Today I was reading this purport. Somehow chamak gaya ho. Right, transparent via media basically means it is coming through the Guru only. The mercy of the Supreme Lord upon fallen souls like us, it is coming through the Lord only. I mean, it is coming through the Guru only. He is like a tube. It's like a tube through which that mercy is flowing, right? And he is connected to his Guru, which is again like a transparent tube. That Guru is connected. So, you know, that Guru is connected to his Guru and so on. It is going all the way up to the Supreme Lord Krishna. These transparent tubes through which the mercy is flowing directly from Krishna to fallen souls like me. These tubes are transparent. So we may not be able to see anything. We are able to directly experience Krishna. because Guru is like a transparent Vaya medium. He's a Vaya medium, but he's transparent. He doesn't come between you and Krishna. Directly you can experience Krishna. Directly you can understand Krishna. Directly you can understand the instructions of Krishna through of the Bhagavad Gita directly. But it is coming via Guru. But it feels like it is coming from Krishna directly. If we are hearing from a transparent via medium, that is the experience we get. That is why we need to take shelter of a Guru. Guru is directly connected with Krishna. It's like an unbroken, oh, kadi pe kadi rehte na, chains. You know, one chain connected to another chain, connected to another chain, connected to another chain, chains. So, ek khicha upar se, to sare chain ke sare kadi upar khich jate. Parampara is like that. It's very powerful. Which is why we must take shelter of a Guru. On our own, it is not possible. I'll not say not possible, but it's very, very difficult to really understand Krishna, to really understand what should I do. Okay, I may still understand Krishna. Oh, he's the Supreme Lord. I may understand myself. Oh, I am eternal spirit soul, part and parcel of Krishna. I may understand that. Okay, ab kya karu? Now what to do with this knowledge? Armed with this knowledge, what should I do now? So unless we have Guru, we will not have the we'll not have the clarity about what we should be doing, which is why surrendering to Guru is very important, right? So that's what Sanjay is explaining here, that through the transparent via medium of the Guru, we can experience and understand Krishna and his instructions. You know, this daily we sing this Guru Ashtakam. In that it said, last verse, Yasya prasadat bhagavat prasado, yasya aprasadat na gati na gatopi. Yasya prasadat bhagavat prasado, yasya prasadat na
gati kutopi. Nagati kutopi.
Nagati kutopi. Sorry, my bad. Thank you. So nagati kutopi, that with the mercy, yasya prasadat bhagavat prasado, with the mercy of Krishna. Sorry, mercy of Guru, yasya prasadat, bhagavat prasado. By the mercy of Guru, we receive the mercy of Krishna. Yasya aprasadat, without the mercy of Guru, na gati kutopi, it is not possible for you to get this param gati. No, it cannot be done. We need a spiritual master, right? So it's very powerful instruction that Srila Prabhupada gives. And Prabhupada also, he refers to the phrase that Sanjaya has made, calling Krishna Yogeshwara, right? He calls him Yogeshwara twice in this section. So here also he calls him Yogeshwara. So Yogeshwara basically means he's the master of all mystics and the master, meaning all yogis. He's the master, Yogi Ishwara. So whoever is a yogi, he is the master of all those yogis, and he is also a master of all the mystic paths. Yoga, Yoga Ishwara or Yogi Ishwara. He is the master of yoga also and yogi also. So whether you are following process of karma, jnana or bhakti, whichever yoga you are following, Krishna is the master of that mystic path. And you are a karma yogi, you are a jnana yogi, you are a bhakti yogi, or you are an ashtanga yogi. Whichever yogi you may be. Yoga basically comes from the root word yuj, which means to join. Join what? To join the spirit soul with the supreme soul. The process of joining is called yoga. So we can connect to Krishna through multiple means. We may connect to him through karma, we may connect to him through jnana, we may connect to him through ashtanga, we may connect to him through bhakti. Whichever means you connect to him, understand he is Yogeshwar. He is the master. And Srila Prabhupada also makes another point here. He says that there is no difference between hearing directly from Krishna and hearing directly from Krishna via a bona fide spiritual master like Vyasadeva. Just one second. Sorry. So there is no difference between hearing directly from Krishna and hearing directly from Krishna via a bona fide spiritual master like Vyasadeva. So we should not feel ki, oh, I'll listen only to Krishna directly. I don't want to hear from anyone else. All the people in this material world are all contaminated and they all have so many anarthas. That's true. That is true. There is no doubt about it. There is hardly a soul in this material world who is not contaminated. Everyone has doshas. Everyone has faults. Everyone has so many things going against them, right? So then what is the qualification of a person who is taking the role of a guru? The main qualification is that they have surrendered their lives in the service of Krishna. And they have also taken shelter of Guru. And they are not deviating from the principles of Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. What their Guru has taught them, what is there in the Shastra, and what the previous Acharyas have taught. It is all in sync with each other. So the Guru's behavior, not his words only, but his behavior, his mansa vacha gira, what is in his thoughts, what is in his words, what is in his actions, they're all very congruent with what? With Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. With his Guru, with previous Acharyas and Shastra. If even one of this it doesn't concur, there's something wrong with that Guru. Don't surrender. Chhanbin karke Guru chuno. Do the, what we call in corporate language as due diligence. Do the due diligence before you surrender to a guru. But once you have chosen a guru, once you have surrendered, uske baad, like Arjun, yes, sir, karishye vachanantava, uske baad, don't ask questions, but guru, why I should listen to you? No. You asked questions, you surrendered. Did I force you to surrender? No. You surrender. You did all the due diligence. Now, just follow. Even if those instructions sometimes hamare dimag mein wo baithta nahi hai because hamara, we are not doordarshi. We don't have far vision. We don't have broad vision. We have very narrow vision. With that narrow vision, how much you will understand? But Guru has, because he is connected, tattvadarshi. He is connected with the parampara. He is connected with Krishna. He is tattvadarshi, so he knows. Therefore, he can tell you what you don't know, what you don't understand also, right? So that's why if a guru is speaking, we should not, think that, oh, I want to hear from Krishna itself. It is known, here Prabhupada is saying it is no difference. There is no difference between hearing from Krishna directly and hearing from Krishna via bona fide spiritual master like Vyasadeva. So this is the acknowledgement that Sanjaya is doing of his spiritual master. He's saying that, I had no qualifications to hear this wonderful conversation between Krishna and Arjuna, but by the mercy of Vyasadeva, no qualification, by his mercy, I was able to hear this beautiful conversation. Then in verse 76, he says, O King, as I repeatedly recall this wondrous and holy dialogue between Krishna and Arjuna, I take pleasure being thrilled at every moment. So here, what is the result of becoming conversant with the Bhagavad Gita? And then, because of being conversant with Bhagavad Gita, when one becomes Krishna conscious, then what happens? That's what Sanjaya is trying to explain. The result of, of being conversant. Because he heard the whole Gita directly from Krishna. So, iska asar kya hua, he is explaining. He's saying, by being conversant with the Gita, one immediately becomes righteous. Righteous meaning what? Usko sahi galat ka discrimination aa jata hai. He comes to know what is wrong, what is right, you know, because Gita is not an ordinary book. It is not an ordinary conversation between some two friends, as some foolish people interpret Gita, that, oh, it is a conversation between two friends. No, it is scripture. Why Gita is revered so much, why it is worshipped so much? Because it is a conversation between God. It is spoken by God himself. Therefore, it is so perfect. That's why each verse of the Gita is perfect and complete. Right? So, he says that by hearing, by becoming conversant with Gita, one becomes righteous. One comes to know ki sahi galat kya hai. You know, if you remember in the 16th chapter when we were discussing divine and demoniac nature, what is the primary criterion of demoniac nature? Primary criterion. That they don't believe in scripture. They don't accept scripture as word of God. That is the first and most important criteria of being demoniac, that you don't have faith in scripture. So when we have faith in scripture, when we become faithful, when we become conversant, when we study the scripture, automatically over a period of time, we come to know what is right, what is wrong. No one needs to tell you, just instinctively you will know. Nahin, ye sahi nahi hai, ye galat hai. Ha, you may not have the, you may not have the willpower. You may not have the spiritual strength to do it, to do the right thing. But you will know that this is right, this is wrong. And right now I am weak, so I'm not doing this, I'm doing this. But I know the consequences. I'm willing to face the consequences. Willing to face the music for having made the wrong choice. Right? So you become righteous. Then what happens? He says, he cannot forget such thoughts. Okay, this is a very interesting thing. Sanjay is saying, in this verse, he's saying, as I repeatedly recall this wondrous and holy dialogue, right? Repeatedly recall, bhulta nahi hai, usko bar bar yaad aata hai. He is amazed that, Krishna said this. In second chapter, he said this. Then in the fourth chapter, he said this. Then sixth chapter, he spoke about Dhyan Yoga. By the end of it, he says that of all the yogis, the devotee is the best. Acha, I always thought yogis are great, but Krishna has very clearly said, Bhaktya Maam Abhijanati. Only through bhakti I am to be known. Wow, amazing. So he is remembering all these things. And by remembering this and becoming Krishna conscious, what is the result? He says one becomes increasing. Prabhupada says one becomes increasingly enlightened. Increasingly enlightened. Not that Bhagavad Gita ek bar padh liya. Like see, when we actually happens even in material knowledge, like aapko engineering ka kitab padho, ek bar padho, sab bouncer jata hai, above the head. But then you read it a second time, you read it a third time, you listen to a lecture of your professor, who kisi ne notes likha hai, usko refer karte ho, padhte 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 padhte, dhire dhire, you become increasingly enlightened. The Bhagavad Gita is like that. It is not that I heard it once, fill it, shut it, forget it. No, sir. We must keep hearing the Gita. Not that we have completed abhi 10 saal se hum log bhid rahe hai Gita ke saath, bas ho gaya. No. Again. Pick it up again. Read it again. Because it will increasingly enlighten. The same verse which you read maybe 2 years, 3 years, 10 years back, you read it again today, it will give you different realizations. It is transcendental. It is not ordinary. Right? So, one becomes increasingly enlightened. Then, he says, such a person enjoys life with a thrill. Right? He says, I take pleasure. Sanjay is saying, I take pleasure being thrilled at each moment, at every moment. Prabhupada says that one who is in Krishna consciousness enjoys life with a thrill. Not only for some time, but with every moment, right? So, now one may say, kaha yaar, kaha yeh sab, Prabhupada ne thoda jyada hi bol diya yeh toh. Matlab, I don't feel like that, right? You feel that way. But you know, understand, these are the words of the acharyas. These are the words of those people who have lived this path, who have made Krishna the center of their life, who have surrendered everything, nothing. अपने लिए एक उन्होंने एक एक धागा भी नहीं रखा है खुद के लिए. Everything they have given up for Krishna. And when you experience in this material body, when you experience the bliss of Krishna consciousness, we may not get it at every moment. We may get it at only few moments. बीच बीच में भगवान हमको एक स्वाद देते हैं. ये लो बेटा, चख के देख लो. Sometimes you hear some nice kirtan and it touches your heart. ऐसा हृदय को चीर के निकल जाता. Sometimes some guru comes to the temple, some sannyasi, some senior devotee of Srila Prabhupada. He comes and he speaks something very simple, but it touches the heart. यहाँ पे हम लोग बोले जा रहे. It may not touch your heart, but some person who's been living bhakti for 40 years, 50 years, such a person comes and says something very simple and completely pierces the heart. Aisa cheer ke nikal jata hai, right? What is that? That moment of realization that you got, that moment of love for Krishna that you felt, for just that split second, you felt love for Krishna, you felt love for his kirtan, you felt love for the holy name. That is the experience that Prabhupada is speaking about, right? So he's saying that this, you enjoy life with a thrill. Like Sanjay, aisa rongte khade ho gaye. Ekdam hriday waise aisa fawware chhoot rahe. You know, it's like waves of ecstasy coming. You're not able to control it. Eyes are, tears are coming out of the eyes. You're not able to control it. That moment may last only for one split second. Sometimes it is kirtan, sometimes it is prasad, sometimes it is whatever. But that one moment that you experience that ecstasy, that thrill that Prabhupada is speaking about, that is Krishna's mercy. It is his mercy. It is not that you deserved it. देखो मैंने काफी फाइट मारा है, काफी टाइम से मैंने चाय कॉफी छोड़ा है, काफी टाइम से मैंने ये हरे कृष्ण महामंत्र का जप किया है, काफी टाइम से मैं ये भगवत गीता का सुन रहा हूँ, झेल रहा हूँ 10 साल से. क्या प्रभु, कुछ तो अपने को मर्सी दो भगवान. क्या ये अच्छा मर्सी दिया, सी आई डिजर्व इट. नो, नथिंग वी कैन डू इन दिस वर्ल्ड इज सफिशियंट टू एक्सपीरियंस डायरेक्टली कृष्ण. नथिंग. We can never deserve Krishna. We can never deserve the Sakshat Darshan of the Supreme Lord, the Sakshat experience of Krishna. We have done nothing and we cannot do anything. Remember this very important concept that you cannot conceivably do anything in the world which qualifies you to say that I deserve to see the Lord. And then there are people in this world who say ki, लाओ भगवान को सामने. अगर तुम कहते हो भगवान है, दिखाओ, लाओ उनको सामने. अरे तुम हो कौन भाई कि भगवान तुम्हारे लिए सामने आ जाएंगे? तुम कौन हो? Who are you? Do you deserve? If you say that I want Chief Minister of Maharashtra to come in front of you, will he come? कौन हो तुम? Nobody. Right? So to understand that this enjoys life with a thrill, not only for some time, but at every moment. This is possible if we are surrendered to Krishna. When you are surrendered, it's like the kitten, like the kitten. Prabhupada gives the example, the monkey, the young one of the monkey, they hold on to, the mother monkey. And as the mother monkey jumps from place to place, it is their power with which they are holding on. Whereas the cat, if you see, cat lifts, even sometimes dogs do it rarely, but they do. But cats do it very often. They pick up their kittens between their teeth. They hold them near the neck like this over here. From here, they hold them from back. They hold them, they take them to a place of safety. So that same mouth, Prabhupada says, if a rat is in the mouth of that cat, it is death personified. But for that kitten, that mouth is just ecstatic. He feels very happy. He feels safe. So for a devotee who has understood that Krishna is my well-wisher, Suridam Sarva Bhutanam Gyatva Mam Shanti Mrichati, he becomes peaceful. Usko koi chinta nahi hai world mein, because Krishna is taking care. Rakhe Krishna mare ke, mare Krishna rakhe ke. Who can hurt me if Krishna is protecting me? And if Krishna anyway wants me to suffer, who can protect me? Hatao, I don't want. Such a person is blissful. Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma na sochati na kangshati. He's Prasannatma. He's happy, satisfied, because he's connected with Krishna. Right? So we need to connect with Krishna. We can experience this thrill at every moment. Sometimes people come and ask devotees, "Are you so khush kaise lagte ho yaar? How you devotees look so happy? You're always smiling. How come you're smiling so much?" In my office also, sometimes people used to ask me. I have one of my colleagues here from SAP. Ravi is on the call with us. So he will know what kind of a pressure cooker we used to work in. You know, both of us were in SAP together. It's an absolute pressure cooker. Every quarter, every 3 months, you know, you have to deliver some sales. And if you don't deliver, they will, you know, insult you. They will torture you. They make your life miserable. Heavy stress environment, right? But in that stress environment, we used to have a smile on our face. So we used to say, how are you so happy? I don't know. My happiness is not connected to my doing my target or not doing my target. My happiness is connected to something else. So I'm happy. So we can be happy even in this miserable material world if we are connected to the lotus feet of Krishna and his devotees. We can experience this thrill, this harsha of Krishna consciousness, if we sincerely follow the process. Like the acharyas have given us, like the acharyas have taught to us by their own personal examples, we follow like that, we will also experience. Have the faith. Have faith that they are not here to cheat us. What they have told us, we have to have full faith in those words. Right? So, result of becoming Krishna conscious, enjoys life with a thrill, not only for some time, but at every moment. Then in text 77, Sanjaya, now he says, O king, right? In the previous verse also he said, O king, Rajan, right? Here also he is saying, O king, as I remember the wonderful form of Lord Krishna, I am struck with wonder more and more, and I rejoice again and again. So which form is he speaking about? He is speaking about what form of Krishna has he seen? So Srila Prabhupada explained that the form that was shown by Krishna to Arjuna in the 11th chapter when Arjuna said that I want to see your universal form. So Krishna told him that this form that I'm showing you has not been seen by anybody else. Aaj tak kisi ne ye dekha nahi. So main aapko special drishti deta hun. I give you special eyes by which you will be able to see this form. Otherwise you can't see. So therefore, Arjuna was able to see this. Others on the battlefield couldn't see it. Only Arjuna. It was a private show. Like a private show for Arjuna. Only the demigods who had transcendental vision, they could see. The rishis who were in the higher planets, they could see. Arjuna could see. One more person could see. Who is that? Sanjaya could see. Sanjaya was not granted vision by Krishna. Krishna gave that vision to Arjuna. So who gave vision to Sanjaya then? Srila Prabhupada explains, again, it is Vyasadeva. So he has already expressed his gratitude to Vyasadeva that because of Vyasadeva, I could hear this transcendental conversation. Again, it is because of Vyasadeva only he was able to see this fantastic sight of the universal darshan. We have been through it in the 11th chapter. We have been through this description. It is undescribable. Right? It's not possible to describe in words what is this universal form. थोड़ा बहुत कुछ इधर उधर से यू नो उठा के हम लोग कुछ बोल सकते हैं बट वी कैन नॉट इवन इमेजिन व्हाट इज द यूनिवर्सल फॉर्म सो ही इज एक्सप्रेसिंग हिज ग्रैटिट्यूड दैट वाज एबल टू सी दिस एंड ही इज सेइंग व्हाट इज ही सेइंग आई हैव रिमेंबर दिस वंडरफुल फॉर्म ऑफ कृष्णा लॉर्ड कृष्णा ही हैज ऑलरेडी स्पोकन अबाउट यू नो द वर्ड्स ऑफ कृष्णा आई हर्ड द वंडरफुल वर्ड्स ऑफ कृष्णा एंड अर्जुना उनका ये फॉर्म देख अद्भुत फॉर्म इट्स लाइक अ अद्भुत ट्रांसेंडेंटल वंडरफुल फॉर्म I am struck with wonder more and more. Again, the word wonder is coming. Three times in this section is used the word wonder. Wonderful conversation, wondrous and holy dialogue. And now he says, I am struck with wonder more and more. Again, or wonder I am in the inside. What is this form? In which, what has he seen in this form? He has seen that It is the source of everything in this material world. यार एक एक कण कण का स्रोत है ये. It is the source of everything. He is saying that it is like kala, kalo, you know, kalosmi, lokakshaya krit pravriddho. Krishna explains that I am time, which is consuming and killing everyone. And Arjuna sees it. He is able to see that all the Kaurava warriors are entering into the mouth of this form. Fire is coming out of the mouth. And these warriors are entering into that mouth. Some are getting stuck in the ghastly teeth of this ghastly universal form. And Arjuna is seeing this. Sanjaya is seeing this. There are two people on this earth who are seeing it. मैच इज ऑलरेडी फिक्स्ड ऑलरेडी रिजल्ट डिक्लेयर हो चुका है कि ये लोग सब मरने वाले दे विल ऑल डाई एंड दिस इज ऑलरेडी बीन सीन बाय कृष्णा इट इज सीन बाय संजय सो संजय इज प्रिवी टू द फैक्ट दैट द कौरवास आर गोइंग टू बी डिफीटेड उसने देखा है अर्जुन हैज सीन इट संजय हैज सीन इट Right, so he's privy to this fact, and therefore he's saying, "I am struck with wonder more and more, and I rejoice again and again." He's rejoicing; he's so happy that I got to see this. पता नहीं कहाँ से मुझे ये देखने को मिल गया. I did not deserve it, but just my fortune, I got to see it. He's so grateful, right? So this is the wonderful reciprocation of Sanjaya. Where he is explaining again by the mercy of Vyasadeva, I was able to see this form. And then, you know, Sanjaya in the final verse, you come to the last verse. Let's read the verse again. Very beautiful. Yatra Yogeshwaro Partha, Yatra Yogeshwaro Krishna, Yatra Partha Dhanurdhara, Tatra Shrir Vijayo Bhutir Dhruvani Tir Matir Mama. He says, wherever there is Krishna, the master of all mystics, Wherever there is Arjuna, the supreme archer, there will also certainly be opulence, victory, extraordinary power and morality. That is my opinion. So, Sanjaya started his conclusion, right? He started his conclusion, the last, Sanjaya Uvacha, in 74, verse 74. He started his conclusion how? By glorifying the Bhagavad Gita, by glorifying its speaker, by glorifying its listener. He spoke about its effect on him. Then he spoke about this transcendental form which he saw of, you know, the Supreme Lord Krishna in his ghastly form as the universal, you know, Virat Rupa. So as he is meditating like this on the instructions of the Gita, Gita is spoken by whom? It is spoken by Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Who is the source of all material and spiritual worlds, and he has said it in so many words. And he has proven it also. And then there is Arjuna also, who is listening, who is not some ordinary listener. He is the greatest archer in the universe, most powerful person in the universe. He is on the side of Yudhishthira, who is Dharmaraj. And then he, last thing he does is he meditates on this universal form, where he has seen all the Kauravas being crushed within the mouth of the universal form. Suddenly unko chamak jata hai, and he dismisses any hopes that Dhritarashtra must have had. Because unko bhi, by meditating on the words of the Gita, by meditating on the effect of seeing this universal form, it dawns on him. It dawns on him that wherever there is this Krishna, Supreme Lord Krishna, Yogeshwara, you may have some yogis in your side. Maybe Bhishma is a yogi. Drona may be a yogi. Kripa may be a yogi. There may be some yogi. Honge, charana, atana, koi honge. But Yogeshwara, the source of all yoga, the master of all yoga, Yogeshwara Krishna, wherever he is there, wherever this master archer Arjuna is there, there is no hope, my friend Dhritarashtra, there is no hope. Bhagavad Gita, how did it begin? It began with Dhritarashtra asking, Dharma Kshetre Kurukshetra Samaveta Yuyutsava Mamaka Pandavascheva Kim Akurvata Sanjaya. Right? It started with Dhritarashtra asking about what happened on this battlefield. Dharma Kshetra Kurukshetra, kya ho gaya idhar? And then Sanjaya starts speaking. So it started with Dhritarashtra's query. That is the first verse of the Gita. Now, in the final verse, Sanjaya is closing the door on Dhritarashtra. Because now he has realized by hearing the Gita and by seeing Krishna, he realizes, Baba, Krishna and Arjuna cannot be defeated. And you have no hope of victory. Wherever there is Krishna, the master of all mystics, Yogeshwara, and wherever there is Arjuna, the supreme archer, there will certainly be opulence. Opulence will be there. There will be victory. There will be extraordinary power. Matlab aap power ka, when he has seen this power of this universal form, he says that it is extraordinary. Your people may have some power, ordinary power. It's extraordinary. Koi chance nahi hai, aapke ye bhagwan hai. Ye chahe to ek second mein ye sab khatam kar denge. You have no chance. Right? So, what do we understand from this? So, this is the conclusion of the Gita. Here, with this, the final, you know, A of the Gita ends, where Sanjaya has conclusively shut the door on any hopes that Dushasan, Drona, Karna, or Dhritarashtra, or any of the generals in that battle, in that side had. He's closed the door. It's over. Battle is over. You're going to lose it. Khatam. Because Krishna and Arjuna are there. It's over. Right? For us, how do we understand? Right? When he says that where there is Krishna and where there is Arjuna, the expert archer, there is opulence, victory, extraordinary power and morality. This sounds good, doesn't it? Hame bhi lagta hai ki yaar, mere ko bhi chahiye. I also would like to have this, you know, this opulence and this victory and extraordinary power and morality. Wouldn't we like to have it? So let's understand what is the meaning for us, right? At our level. This means that wherever there is the Lord, wherever Krishna is there, Krishna is actually everywhere. But in our lives, hum jis had tak Bhagwan ko hamare jindagi mein laate hain aur apne jeevan ka kendra banate, we make it the center, the substance of our life, the center of our life, right? To the extent that Krishna is there in our life and there is his expert devotee who is also surrendered. Just being expert in some field is not good enough. Surrender is needed. That is what the ultimate instruction of the Gita is, where Krishna tells Arjuna that become my devotee, think of me, become my devotee, just pay obeisances unto me, then you will come to me. Surrender unto me. Don't be afraid. Just surrender. So, however expert you may be, like Arjuna, Arjuna was an expert archer. But because he surrendered to Krishna, that's why he became the instrument in the hands of Krishna to win the battle. Correct? So, therefore, wherever there is a Lord and wherever there is this expert and surrendered devotee, there will always be these things like opulence, victory, extraordinary power and morality. And we have seen this. Ye toh fairy tale ho gaya. No. If you read Prabhupada, what was his, you know, what were his achievements? In a span of 11 years, who creates 108 temples? Batao, kon kar? 108 temples. Some 5,000 disciples. So many books. Kon karta hai? Who can do this? Who can write like this? And reply to letters of all his disciples and have personal dealings with them and attend Mangal Aartis and give Bhagavatam class and this and that. And it's like time became conspicuous by its absence for Prabhupada. That 11 years expanded into 11,000 years. So many things he was able to do in those 11 years. It's unbelievable. Abhi bhi agar aap Prabhupada Leelamrit padoge, it reads like a fairy tale. You can't believe it's true. It's so amazing. This is that opulence. This is that victory. This is that extraordinary power and morality that Srila Prabhupada got. Why? Wherever there is Yatra Yogeshwaro Krishna, Yatra Partha Dhanurdhara. Right? The expert archer, Srila Prabhupada, who shot arrows of Krishna consciousness at all the bewildered souls of this material world. Sat. He just kept shooting arrows. It is described Arjuna, the way he was shooting arrows, one couldn't see his hand moving. It was so fast. One couldn't see. If you read description of the Mahabharata, there are descriptions given of Arjuna, you know, fighting with yakshas and fighting with so many people. It's described that they couldn't see his hands moving. Like, shot, next arrow, placed, shot. It was like a blur, that fast. Right? In that pace, Prabhupada shot his transcendental Krishna arrows. Right? Amazing. This is the power and, you know, of the Lord. So, we have to understand at our level, wherever the Lord is there in our lives and we are using whatever expertise we have with full surrender to Krishna, these things will manifest in our life also. We will also get opulence. We will also get success and victory. We will also get extraordinary power to do whatever service we are doing. We will get it. We have to have that faith. It may manifest immediately. It may manifest after some time. But as per the conclusion of the Gita, we have to have full faith, oh, they will certainly manifest. There is no doubt about it. Right? We have to have faith in the message of the Gita, and regardless of whatever our expertise, we should surrender to Krishna. You may be the best doctor in this world. You may be the best chemical engineer in the world. You may be the best software engineer in the world. You may be the best sales guy in the world. You may be the best of anything. You may be the most expert like Arjuna. Regardless of your expertise, he should surrender to Krishna. Surrender. Right? Become an insignificant instrument in his hands and allow the magic to happen. Right? Because you are like a person who अपना हाथ पपेट जैसा बन गया, like Srila Prabhupada when he wrote that poem on the Jaludutva, when he was going to the US, when he had nothing, he had just 40 rupees with him and some books of Bhagavatam, that's it, and the instructions of his guru, that's all he had. With that he went to the US and he sings in that prayer which he composed on the Jaludutva, nachao nachao, make me dance like a puppet, I'm a puppet in your hand. So if we become puppets who are operated by Yogeshwara Krishna, by the Supreme Lord, right? If we are humbly becoming that instrument, as Krishna tells in the Gita, it tells, Nimitta Matra Bhava Savyasachi. Just become Nimitta. Become an instrument in my hands. Allow the magic to happen. That magic may or may not appeal to us. Like the battle of Kurukshetra, even after all the instructions of Krishna and with full conviction Arjuna fought, the end result didn't appeal to him. Bhishma on a bed of arrows, Drona beheaded. He didn't like it. That magic may or may not appeal to us. But if we humbly and sincerely follow the instructions of Krishna, which are coming to us in parampara, then regardless of the result, we will become victorious. In the eyes of Krishna, we may not feel victorious in our own eyes. We may say, ye kya victory hai, yaar, sab mar gaye. Kya victory hai? But in the eyes of Krishna, the Supreme Lord, we will be victorious. That is the perfection of our life. So these are the messages that we have to pick up from the Gita. Not that khali, oh, karm karo, karm karo, karm karo. No. There's a lot more rasa in the Bhagavad Gita. There's a lot more, very life-changing instructions that we can pick up from the Gita. What do we have to do? We have to be like Arjuna. We have to be an instrument in the hands of Krishna. Surrendered. If the instrument starts struggling in the hands of Krishna, hey, I sound, don't do this. Hey, Krishna, please, you take care of this while you're doing this, then I'm okay. Instrument doesn't ask questions to the surgeon. Instrument, the scalpel in the hand of the surgeon, is completely surrendered. Surgeon uses the scalpel to do the operation. That's it. We have to also become that scalpel in the hands of the expert surgeon, Shri Krishna. Follow instructions of the Supreme Lord as we are hearing from our Guru, from Parampara, whatever we receive. If we just follow these instructions, regardless of the result, magic or not magic, right? We will be successful, victorious in the eyes of Krishna. So just to conclude, Srila Prabhupada, he summarizes the five principal topics of the Gita in his purport. The last two paragraphs, I would request everyone to read it, because that is what is the final concluding thing that Srila Prabhupada says in the Gita. He summarizes the five principal topics of the Gita in his purport. I'm sorry, I will take a few more minutes to conclude, because this is the last lecture we're having on the Gita verses. So I'll just conclude in another 5-10 minutes. Sorry for going a little about time. So Srila Prabhupada summarizes the five principal topics of the Gita, which is Ishvara, Jiva, Prakriti, Karma, and Kala. Right? So these are the five principal topics. So how do we understand the intertwining? Now we have heard everything. Pura sunke ho gaya Gita, sab kuch ho gaya abhi. Kya hai bolne ke liye? So let us just now try to bring it all together, right? Just in a very short way. The Jiva, the eternal Jiva, which is all of us, the spirit soul, in forgetfulness of Ishvara, the second topic of Gita, right? Jiva, the eternal soul, who has forgotten his eternalness and forgotten Ishvara, in forgetfulness of Ishvara, uses his or her minute independence to do what? To whimsically perform good and bad karma under the control of Prakriti. He feels that I am the controller, but he is being controlled by Prakriti, material nature. That's the third element, right? And he, under the control of Prakriti, he performs good and bad karma whimsically. मेरे को लगता है ऐसा करने का, मेरे को आज ये करने का मन कर रहा, मेरे को आज वो करने का मन, whimsically. There is no basis of scripture. So the jiva, in forgetfulness of Krishna, under the control of Prakriti, using his or her minute independence, whimsically performs good or bad karma in the continuum of time, kala. This is what the living entity does. Doing good or bad karma under control of prakriti in forgetfulness of Krishna. Under control of prakriti and time. Right? Because of that, the living entity gets attached to husband, to wife, to children, to parents, to friends, to enemies, to jobs, to business, to bank balance, to beauty, to strength, to wealth, to knowledge, to renunciation. He gets attached to so many things. Because of his attachment to the fruits that are coming from his whimsical good or bad karma, he gets entangled in the cycle of birth and death. Punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam, punarapi janani, jathare shayanam. This is the summary of all living entities in this material world. I hope that's clear. It was a lot of words, a lot of English there, but I hope you get the concept. I'll summarize again. The living entity Jiva, in forgetfulness of Ishvara, uses his minute independence to whimsically perform good or bad karma under the control of Prakriti and Kala. Because of that, he gets attached to the fruits of good and bad karma. Because of that, he gets entangled in the cycle of birth and death, and he keeps going sometimes into higher species, sometimes into lower species. But a brahma bhuvana loka punaravartino Arjuna, that from the lowest living entity to Brahma, this place is a birth, place of rebirth. Again and again you are born. So what is the way out? The Gita gives us the way out of this cycle. How does it happen? When the Jiva hears, Brahmanda Brahmite Kona Bhagyavan Jiva, Guru Krishna Prasade Paye Bhakti Lata Beej. Brahmanda Brahmite, this living entity who is roaming in the Brahmand, in the universe, through different species, sometimes pig, sometimes human, sometimes elephant, sometimes insect, sometimes fish, sometimes plant. Brahmanda Brahmite, Kona Bhagyavan Jeev. Bhagyavan means what? Fortunate. Again, not deserving. Fortunate. Uska nasib jaag gaya. Guru Krishna Prasade Paye. By the mercy of Guru and Krishna, Paye Bhakti Lata Beej. Gets the seed of Bhakti. Right? So then this Jiva hears from Guru. Now we come to the Gita, the message of the Gita. Right? We spoke about the entangled, attached, desperate living entity who is under control of time and prakriti because of forgetfulness of Krishna and therefore is stuck in material world. Now we come to the Jiva hears from the Guru in parampara and acts in bhakti. Acts, what is bhakti? Acting for the pleasure of Krishna. Acts in bhakti. Such a person directly comes under the order, he comes under the order of Krishna. So he hears from Guru. Because of hearing and performing bhakti yoga, he comes directly under the order of Krishna. And thus, because of Krishna being the controller of all four, he is the controller of Jiva, he is the controller of Prakriti, he is the controller of Kala, he is the controller of Karma also. He is the controller of everything, right? So, because he is acting in bhakti yoga, after hearing in parampara, he comes under the order or jurisdiction of the Supreme Lord Krishna, because of which the influence of Prakriti and Kala is diminished and finally eliminated. Nikal gaya picture se. And this person develops love for God. With that love, he finally returns to the spiritual world to serve the Lord in his constitutional position, eternal spiritual body. That is the message. That is the biggest benediction of the Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita can give you opulence, like we just discussed, it can give you extraordinary power because it is Krishna. It is the direct instructions of Krishna. It can give you all these things. But really what Gita can give you, it can give you pure bhakti. It can give you directly take you out of the jurisdiction. Matlab, aap jail mein atke ho, jail se aap mukt hoke free ho jaoge. Will be freed from the cycle of prakriti and kala and karma and all that. This has been going on for unlimited lifetimes. Kabhi se chalte aa raha hai. Ye sab se aap mukt ho jaoge. And you will be able to go back to the spiritual world, Goloka, the residence of the Supreme Lord Krishna. He has explained in many places. Think of me, you will come to me. Become my devotee, you will come to me. Think of me at the last moment, you will come to me. Punarjanmana vidyate. So many places in the Gita. Krishna has given this assurance. We should understand, just to summarize, I'll end with this. The Bhagavad Gita is a magnificent, glorious, and enlivening message. It is not like an ordinary book from some mundane author. It is the Lord's own potency of knowledge. Lord is speaking directly. That potency of knowledge with which he enlightens the fallen souls. Then, one who studies the Bhagavad Gita, therefore, experiences direct association with Lord Krishna. So when we hear Bhagavad Gita, when we read Bhagavad Gita, directly we are associating with Krishna, the Supreme Lord, in the same way that Sanjaya and Arjun heard from him. You have that fortune too, my friend. You can also hear like that. Then, one who hears properly becomes Krishna conscious. He can see Krishna in all things. Krishna has already said in seventh chapter, I am in this also, I am that also, I am source of this also, I am source of that also. But you become Krishna conscious, you can see Krishna in everything. Therefore his life becomes thrilling and exciting and wondrous at every step. Because har cheez mein usko Bhagwan dikhti hai in this self same body. And then when he goes back to the spiritual world, it's very natural. It's not an unnatural thing. So when one is Krishna conscious, last statement, and I'll end with this. When one is Krishna conscious, he appreciates Krishna's position as the supreme shelter of all. Supreme shelter of everyone. It is Krishna's will that is supreme. Therefore, the devotee surrendering to that will find only victory. And will never find defeat. Because the Supreme Lord has decided that this will happen. Whether that is to your liking or not, it is the will of Krishna. And that is the final message of the Gita. Just give up all your conceptions and surrender to me. Don't worry about all sinful reaction and everything. I will take care. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Srila Gurudev ki jai. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Gaur Bhaktavrind ki jai. Nitai Gaur Premanandi. Hari Hari Bol. Thank you. Hare Krishna. So is there any questions or comments anybody has before we conclude?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Can I ask one question?
Yeah, who is this? Sorry.
This is Sudha Lakshmi Narayanan Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna. I can't see you, Mataji, but yeah, Hare Krishna. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Thank you so much for this lovely, lovely, wonderful class. I just have one question on today's class. You said ultimately Krishna is the controller of Jiva, Prakriti, Kala and Karma.
Yeah.
So karma is something the living entity gets on because of his own action or his own, like you said, sinful or whimsical actions.
Yeah.
So it is something which he, because of his own individual independence choices. he gets it. So is there how can we say that Krishna is controlling that, Prabhuji?
So Krishna is not controlling our activities, okay, but what comes out of that activity is controlled by Krishna. See, our that's what the Gita, one of the hidden messages of the Gita is that you're not the controller, right? Prakriti kriyamanani gune karmani sarvasya ahankar vimudatma kartaham iti manyate. So the person thinks that they are the doer, whereas actually Krishna is the doer, but doing through the agency of material nature. So we can only express our desire that I want to do such and such thing. Then Krishna, the super soul, sanctions that desire. Material nature looks at Krishna. Kya karun? Boss, should I fulfill this desire or not? Boss says, go ahead. Uske paas karma ka bahut balance hai. Go ahead. And then everything, bang, 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 bang. Everything falls into place. And material nature organizes everything. All circumstances are favorable and things happen. Right? So to that extent, he is the controller of karma, the result that comes. He is the controller of the effort that you put also, because if material nature doesn't cooperate, aapko suppose right now you want to reach out and hit the leave meeting button. Okay. Right? If material nature doesn't cooperate, your finger, while you're raising only, aapko ek cramp aa jayega and you will not be able to do it. राइट या आपको वो बटन का ऊपर वो बटन दिखाई नहीं देगा, चश्मा नहीं है, दिखाई नहीं दे रहा है किधर बटन, दिखाई नहीं देगा. राइट, सो दैट्स हाउ वी अंडरस्टैंड दैट कृष्णा इज द कंट्रोलर इवन ऑफ आवर कर्मा. वी कैन शो डिजायर, बट फॉर दैट डिजायर टू फ्रक्टिफाई द सुप्रीम लॉर्ड हैज टू गिव इट सैंक्शन. सो टू दैट एक्सटेंट, डज इट आंसर योर क्वेश्चन?
यस प्रभुजी, थैंक यू प्रभुजी, हरे कृष्णा, थैंक यू.
Any other questions?
Very nice, Prabhuji. Very nice. Prabhuji, one small clarification, since you mentioned about this transparent wire media.
Yes,
sir. Do I understand this is that it is unadulterated, unfiltered transfer of knowledge from top to bottom? It's like without any change. Does it mean the same thing?
Yes. Prabhupada used to say, that another analogy he gives is like, he says, I'm like a postal peon, like a postman. Postman kya karta hai? When you write a letter, you put in an envelope, you write the address, and give it to, you post it. The postman picks it up from post box and delivers it. Does the postman open the letter, remove it, read it? यार ये इसने ना इंग्लिश अच्छा नहीं लिखा है, मेरे को नहीं जमा, मैं इसको आई जस्ट कट दिस एंड आई चेंज द लैंग्वेज, यू नो आई एम नॉट इम्प्रेस्ड विद दिस मैसेज, ओनली मैसेज ही अच्छा, फॉरगेट द लैंग्वेज, मैसेज ही अच्छा नहीं, मैसेज मैं बदल के भेजता हूँ. डज द पोस्टमैन डू दैट? ही डज नथिंग ऑफ द सॉर्ट. ही जस्ट टेक्स द लेटर एंड डिलीवर्स इट एज इट इज टू द राइटफुल रेसिपिएंट. सेम वे गुरु ऑल्सो takes what he has received from his guru, wahi envelope, wahi lifafa, wo aake hamare samne aise pesh karta, wo apna khud ka usme kuch tadka mirchi add nahi karta, he has to repeat what he has heard from his guru. That is the essence. Yes, he may adjust the message as per time, place and circumstance, but doesn't change the message.
The theme is the message.
That's what. So that is what is the meaning of unadulterated, unchanged, what you said. Yes. Guru is like that.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Prabhuji, may I?
Yes, Prabhu. Who is that?
It was wonderful, wondrous and magical listening to you for the last five verses. And it was Roma Harshanam for me, you know, listening to you, you know, so beautifully, especially the summary that you have so wonderfully summarized. And you said, you know, universal form was ghastly. In 11th chapter, 45 verse, Arjuna is still saying that, I'm gladdened that you've shown me this, but at the same time, I'm fearful of this. So ghastly, so that by fear was sort of invoked in him? Was it so ghastly in the sense, of course, a lot of people were, everybody was going to the teeth and all that you beautifully described. So is it like, you know, we don't have that vision, of course. You have to be the mercy of that. So was it ghastly?
Death is ghastly, Prabhu. Death is ghastly. I mean, for anybody. You see, like, there are stories of people who have seen Yamdutas. Abhi bhi WhatsApp pe kuch, you know, circulate hote rehta hai. Some people saw Yamdutas and they were very ghastly to look at. Why they're ghastly? It's not because they are dark and they have, you know, sharp pointy teeth. They're ghastly because they're taking you away from your body, from everything that you have held dear all your life. Foolishly, all the things that we have accumulated and held dear in our life, they're going to be snatched away from us at the time of death. That's why death is ghastly. It's horrible, painful. So when you see death of so many, like today, actually, one of my father's counselees, she expired. Okay, she was, must have been 70 plus. And she had undergone a bypass surgery recently in Lilavati. And looks like something went down there, went wrong. And suddenly she developed complications, low blood pressure. And today at 3 o'clock, she left her body. One devotee leaves their body. All devotees feel pain. Imagine if you are seeing death of hundreds and thousands of lakhs of people in one go. A soft-hearted devotee is unable to see it. It's too much. That's why it's ghastly.
Okay, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Yeah, anybody else?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dandavat Pranam.
Hare Bol, Mataji.
Prabhuji, I like that analogy which you have given about the scalpel and the expert surgeon. Krishna is the expert surgeon and we are the like scalpel, and we should move because the scalpel moves as per surgeon's desire. So even we should move according to his desire. And but Prabhuji, even we have free will. So even that free will should get channelized as per his will. You want to say that?
When we use our free will to surrender to Krishna's will,
yes,
that's when it becomes surrender, no? See, as long as I use my free will, ki dekho Krishna, aapne kaha hai Gita mein man mana bhava mat bhakto, aur mere ko banna bhi hai, lekin mere ko thoda samay chahiye. I need some time. Give me some space. Then I will do it, right? So what are we doing? We are expressing our desire that Krishna, I like you. You know, you're kind of a nice guy. I like you. But not right now. I'm not going to surrender to you right now, right? So when we behave like that, we are expressing our independence. And Krishna will never stop you. He's okay. He wants you to come of your own will. Not that he forced you to come. So he waits patiently for the living entity to express his will to surrender to Krishna. That my will is no longer important now, my Lord. Now I will do what you want. Karishye vachanam tava. Right? So till we come to that point of karishye vachanam tava, we will keep expressing our independent will. But in small ways, if we just follow the instructions of Guru, Guru and Sadhu and Shastra, small ways, like we start chanting. It's against our conditioned nature to chant, but we chant. We are inattentive while chanting, but we still struggle. We like to eat all kinds of rubbish foods. We have eaten all our lives, but now we stopped eating. So these small things which we do, chota, take small steps, right? When you take these small steps towards Krishna, Krishna also reciprocates. You start feeling him in your life. You can start seeing the hand of Krishna in your life. You can feel the hand of Krishna in your life. You will start seeing Krishna everywhere. Then, today, reluctantly, we are acting as instrument in his hand. We will be less reluctant. We will be more willing. After some point of time, it will be a pleasure. Krishna, every activity that we do in the day, will be Krishna conscious. It takes time for us to come to that stage. Till that stage, we will always be expressing our independent will, and Krishna allows that. He is fine with it. He is waiting for us to use our independent will to meet his will. To come to that point of Karishya Vachanam. Is that okay?
Yes, Prabhuji. Nice explanation and wonderful lecture as usual. And Prabhuji, I hope you don't stop here and you continue after Bhagavad Gita also. And we get more and more things to hear from you, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Yeah, Prabhuji, I have one question.
Yes.
There is a popular saying, God helps those who help themselves. We have been listening it from our school years onwards.
Yeah.
And is surrendering to God a way of helping ourselves? As you said, just surrender to Krishna. So is surrendering also a way of helping ourselves, that by surrendering we help ourselves?
It's a very thoughtful question, Madhuji. I don't have an answer. Surrendering to Krishna, is it helping ourselves? Yeah, I mean, at one level, when we say helping ourselves,
yes,
we don't even know really what is our self, right? Our self is not our body. It is not our reputation. It is not our, you know, our account statement.
Yeah,
God helps those who help themselves. Yeah. So we generally, in the material sense, we say this, that if you make efforts, then Krishna reciprocates. God reciprocates with the efforts that you're making. God helps those who help themselves. From a spiritual perspective, Krishna in the Gita says, "Ye yatha mam prapadyante tam tatheva bhajamyaham." That as one approaches me, I reciprocate accordingly. So if we approach Krishna with material desires, arthi, artharthi, you know, distressed, wanting artha, wanting wealth, we approach Krishna like that, then Krishna helps those who help themselves. They approach Krishna with material desires, maybe Krishna will fulfill those material desires. But if we want to help our true selves, we want to help our soul.
Right.
Golokeer prem dhan harinam sankirtan. The prem dhan, the wealth of love of the spiritual world is this harinam. So when we take shelter of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, we are really helping ourselves.
That's
and God helps those who help themselves. To that extent, when we chant with sincerity, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, Krishna certainly helps us.
Yeah, thank you, Prabhu. Very powerful lecture.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, myself Upasana.
Yes,
can
Mataji,
I ask
Hare
one
Krishna.
Question?
Yes, Mataji, Hare Krishna.
Yeah. Bhagavad Gita told by Krishna and listened by Arjuna. So there is a complete transformation in Arjuna. And at the end, Sanjaya was also, the message was transmitting to him. There is a transformation in Sanjaya. But Sanjaya also narrating to Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra, there was no transformation in Dhritarashtra.
Like there is no transformation in me, Mataji. I am also speaking and speaking Bhagavad Gita, but there is no transformation in my heart. Radha Gopinath Prabhu always says, no, that information, information, no transformation. So transformation happens when there is a desire to transform. You know, as they say, again, I'm quoting Radha Gopinath Prabhu only. He says, a man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. It's a very humorous way, but a man convinced against his will, against your will, you try to convince somebody, is of the same opinion still. Their opinion will not change. They may externally accept, okay, you have defeated me philosophically, but I care two hoots, I'm not going to change anything, right? So Duryodhan ko itna logo ne samjhaya, itna sara, but he didn't listen. Ravana was convinced so much by his brother, by his ministers, by his wife, by so many, he saw all the signs. Hanuman came and destroyed the whole Sone Ki Lanka. Angad, one insignificant, not insignificant, he was a son of Vali, very powerful. Angad came and nobody could even move his foot 1 second. I mean, so many signs he saw, but no. Vinash Kale Viprita Buddhi. So when destiny is out to get you, because you have surrendered to Maya, you're not surrendered to Krishna. So when destiny is out to get you, no matter how much good counsel comes, if you are thinking that, no, I am the controller, I don't need to listen to anybody, then no matter how much good counsel comes, it's like pouring water on a duck's back. The water simply does not stick. So we have to be careful as devotees that we don't become mini Dhritarashtras who listen to Bhagavad Gita like Sanjaya heard. Sanjaya ne pura repeat kiya, Bhagavad Gita pura suna, are, very nice. Yatra Yogeshwar. It didn't change his decision. It didn't change his decision. He could have said, hey, stop the battle, my sons, I want to save your lives. Mat karo ladai, bas karo, marne walo sab log. It didn't change his decision because he was too attached. He felt there's some hope. Kuch to hoga yaar. Koi to tarkib nikal aayegi. Bhishma hai. Bhishma is like ichcha mrityu wala aadmi. Wo to mar hi nahi sakta hai. To jab tak wo nahi marega, to ye log kaise apne ko defeat karega? Logic hai boss. Nahi ho sakta. But then Krishna is above all logic. He is more intelligent than all of us. He found a way. So the Supreme Lord, when he decides to kill somebody, no matter what you do, you will die. When he decides to protect somebody, no matter what somebody does, he will not die. So we have to understand that the will of the Supreme Lord is supreme. And at the same time, the will of the living entity is also equally supreme. The independence of the living entity is never taken away by Krishna. He gives all good counsel, but he leaves the choice to you. So what do we choose? We have to be careful. Whom do we choose? Whenever decisions come before us, whenever choices come before us, whom do we choose? Do we choose to take from one ear, remove from the other ear? ठीक है यार, ये हर हफ्ते वही चीज दोहराते रहता है. कितना सुनेंगे और कितना हम लोग करेंगे, right? We may think like that. Or we may think that, no, you know, maybe 90% of what this person said, 99% of what he said, it's all good, but not practical. Ye 1% meko achha laga. Chalo, this 1% I will start from today. That is surrender. If Dhritarashtra did that, we wouldn't have the Mahabharata. It would be a different thing. But then, that's what the demoniac nature is. They don't accept authority. They don't accept Krishna. They don't accept the word of God. And that is why we have dharma, adharma in this world. We have to live with it. Hare Krishna. I don't know if that answered your question, Mahatma.
Yes, thank you, Prabhuji. Wonderful explanation.
Hare Krishna.
Prabhuji, I just wanted to add one statement.
Sure.
Dhritarashtra heard everything from Krishna, Sanjaya say, whatever Krishna spoke. But only one statement of Krishna, he had a faith. That is, yathechasi tatha kuru. So he applied that.
And the beautiful, beautiful point, Rimana Prabhu, thank you for saying that. And isn't that our thing also? Don't we all do this? You know, when somebody is lecturing you, are tum aisa kiya, waisa kiya, ye kyun nahi kiya, wo kyun nahi kiya, ye karna chahiye tha, wo karne chahiye tha. So, aap kuch bhi nahi sunte ho, lekin ek koi point aapko chipak jata hai. Are, ye tune aisa bola, haan, ye main karega, bas. And everything else is forgotten. Right? Or in a lecture, and this is particularly I've seen amongst devotees, I've seen this. Sometimes when you want to make a point, no, we don't say, Prabhuji, Mataji, aap aisa mat karo, aap aisa karo. We don't tell directly ever. Okay? We are advised to counsel. Which means what? Which means make a general point. So lecture mein na, hum log kuch ek philosophical point leke bolte hain. Ki ye aisa hota hai, ye aisa karna chahiye. Vaishnava achar matlab like this. This is how you should behave. So, the point for whom it is meant, wo vyakti kya sochta hai? कि ये मेरे लिए नहीं, ये दूसरों के लिए बोल रहे हैं, इट नॉट एप्लीकेबल टू, उसको चमकता ही नहीं है कि ये मेरे लिए पॉइंट बोला जा रहा है. दैट इज द नेचर ऑफ इल्यूजन. सो अनलेस वी टेक शेल्टर ऑफ डिवोटीज कंटिन्यूअसली, वी विल ऑल्सो ओनली हियर यथा इच्छसी तथा कुरु लाइक धृतराष्ट्र. हरे कृष्णा.
ऑल राइट कृष्णा प्रभु जी. रवि हियर, वन क्वेश्चन.
Yes, Ravi.
So the question is, after Krishna conveyed the Bhagavad Gita to Arjun and Arjun fought the war and he followed the principles that Krishna laid out, there is a story which says that at some later point of time, Arjun asks Krishna again, you know, to repeat this knowledge so that, you know, he could go through this again. And Krishna says that, you know, what I did in the battlefield, that was a different situation, and you know, now I cannot repeat the same thing to you again. So the question here is that did Arjun forgot all the teachings of Bhagavad Gita and he lost that surrender to Krishna for which he was asking this again, or is there a different reason? Because we also go through the same thing, you know, when we hear, we are able to create those associations and understand for a while, and then we lose that again.
So I don't know about this story, honestly. I haven't heard this story. So whether the bona fides of it, whether it is true or not true, I don't want to comment on that. But I'll speak about the second part of your question, which is when we also hear Gita, लेक्चर सुनते टाइम जो दिमाग में चिपकता है, चमकता है, जबरदस्त. यू नो, व्हेन आई हियर आल्सो समटाइम्स आई हियर लेक्चर्स ऑफ राधा गोपीनाथ प्रभु, राधानाथ महाराज, वो सुनते तो मतलब इट ऑल मेक्स सो मच सेंस. यार दिस इज अमेजिंग, आई शुड टेक फुल शेल्टर ऑफ भागवतम नाउ. घर जाते ही भागवतम उठा के चालू करो. बट घर जाते ही आवर बेस नेचर हिट्स अस अगेन एंड अगेन, वी गेट बैक टू आवर बैड हैबिट्स, राइट? So this is story of our life as devotees, also as aspiring, I'll not say devotees, we are all aspiring devotees. This story of our life, that we get inspired, then we come home and we do the same thing again. But the beauty of the whole thing is, if we keep hearing, something will stick, and if we keep implementing also. See, if you only hear and you don't implement anything, 100%. See, if you say even the pedagogy principles, right? The principles of teaching. My wife is an educator, so she can comment better. But you say, right, that when something is taught, within the first 1 hour or something, some 60% is lost. Okay. Within 1 day, some 80% is lost. Within 1 week, 90% is lost. And then after another 15 days, almost everything is gone. You have forgotten everything that you heard, right? That is when you have paid attention in the class. Tab ye haal hai, right? But if we hear, and same day that you heard a lecture, same day you go back and revise, you know, little bit, thoda uska revision karte ho, तो वो पॉइंट्स कड़क हो जाता है. दे गो इनटू योर लॉन्ग टर्म मेमोरी एंड देन यू एक्चुअली इंप्लीमेंट व्हाट हैज बीन टॉट. आपने सुना हो, आपने उसको इंप्लीमेंट भी किया, तो वो कॉन्सेप्ट और थोड़ा कड़क बैठ जाता है दिमाग में. इट बिकम्स, यू नो, ये. एंड देन ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम, इफ यू कीप इंप्लीमेंटिंग, इट बिकम्स हैबिचुअल. इट मूव्स फ्रॉम योर कॉन्शियस मेमोरी टू योर अनकॉन्शियस मेमोरी. इट बिकम, like we say, right, you go from incompetent unconscious to the highest level is competent unconscious competent. You're not even conscious, you're just able to drive a car without even thinking, right? So only by practice, by committed practice, can we actually, you know, really imbibe these lessons. By constant hearing, we need to keep hearing. ऐसा नहीं कि एक बार सुना, फिर उसके बाद हम लोग 3 हफ्ते के बाद आए, फिर छोड़ दिया, फिर 3 महीने के बाद आए, फिर 3 हफ्ते आए. नो, वी हैव टू बी कंसिस्टेंट. वी कीप हियरिंग द मैसेज, इट कीप्स रीइंफोर्सिंग. समवेयर दिमाग के अंदर जाके बैठ जाता है. at the appropriate time, if you have heard sincerely, appropriate time, those words will pop out and remind you, hey, Prabhu, aapne ye suna tha, how come you're doing this right now? Don't do it. Stop. And when we feed the good dog, there are good dog and bad dog barking in our heart. If we keep feeding the good dog becomes powerful. If we keep feeding the bad dog overpowers the good dog. So that is the way, that is the way that, you know, we have to, Haribo. So that is the way that we have to, you know, kind of adjust our life in such a way that we are able to manage, you know, and retain more and more and apply more and more like that.
Ruji, can I add one point?
Correct. Yeah, please. Yeah.
One second. I'll just add one point. So, Shastrik way me, if you can understand, see, Manda Sumanda Matayo, Kaliyuga people are having these short memories. But Arjuna is not a product of Kaliyuga. He was in Dwaparyuga, so he never forgot. So that is one Shastrik evidence. Another Shastrik evidence is, in Bhagavatam, it is said when Krishna left the world, Arjuna was coming back from Dwarka to Hastinapur. At that time, the infidel coward man defeated Arjuna. He forgot all skills of his shastra. But at that point of time, it is mentioned in Bhagavatam that he remembered the words of all Bhagavad Gita. So that is one evidence that Arjuna never forgot Bhagavad Gita. So that's wanted to add.
Thank you. Beautiful. Thank you,
Prabhuji. I would like to mention something what Radha Gopinath Prabhuji has told once, that in leisure time, Arjuna requested Krishna again to tell Bhagavad Gita, but he didn't say that I've forgotten, or Krishna never said that it is not in, means that time it was different and now it will be different, because at that time it is known as Anugita, Prabhuji, Anugita. When he told it again, it is Anugita, like Uddhav Gita, and this is Anugita. That's what I remember.
Okay. Thank you, Madhi. All right. If that's it, we can probably conclude. We have gone till 9 o'clock today, but it is a finale session, so I am very grateful.
Ganesh K is raising a hand. I think okay. He has some point.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam. This is Ganesh Kanojia here.
Hare Ganesh Prabhu, Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol Prabhuji. Is it okay if I ask a question, because it's already about time, so I'm little this thing.
Yeah, okay, you can ask.
Prabhuji, this is in line with Shubhangi Mataji only. I think so 50% you have answered in that. I just wanted to know, Prabhuji, if you can emphasize, like in a statement or something, how will you define surrender in one line, if we have to, you know, say, like, is it following the entire instruction of Srila Prabhupada ji is like surrendering, or if according to somebody's capacity, if someone is not able to go down to that level, that means he's not surrendered. So how, I want to understand, what is the surrender exactly? What is the benchmark for surrender? Thank you.
Benchmark for surrender will be different for each person, Prabhu, because each person's life is different, right? There'll be someone who is, you know, a businessman and, you know, sitting on a bank balance of 1,000 crores. Okay, for him to just say, okay, Krishna, I surrender fully. From tomorrow, I will just... Every day I will read Gita, I will worship your deity, I will manmana, bhav, madbhaktu, madhyaji, I will do everything. Koi problem nahi. There will be 100 servants running all around them to take care of everything. So at their level, surrender is different. The surrender of a middle class person who is struggling to provide for his family, you know, and take care of, you know, all the needs of the family, and at the same time practice Krishna consciousness. That will be different, because he'll be spending a lot of time in his office. He'll be spending a lot of time on, you know, family matters, society matters, so many things. And the surrender of a person who's a beggar on the street, who's got nothing, very different. So we really, there is no one line that can be used to describe surrender, at least in my vocabulary, my understanding. But in whatever situation we are, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that in whatever situation we are, with our words, with our thoughts, with our words and our actions, we should try to act in such a manner that it is pleasing to Krishna.
Okay.
Try to mold your activities, your words, your thoughts in such a way that it is pleasing to Krishna. How do I know whether it is pleasing to Krishna or not? Okay. Is it pleasing to the Vaishnavas? Is it pleasing to the devotees? If the answer to that is yes, then I am surrendering. I may not be 100% surrendered. So that's where, right? The percentage of activities, words and thoughts that I have that are pleasing to Krishna or pleasing to the Vaishnavas, maybe today only 2%, maybe it is 10%, right?
Okay.
But if I can ramp up that percentage from 10 to 15, I have made progress. So
okay.
Keep our life simple, you know, just try to act in such a way, anukulyasya sankalpo pratikulyasya varjanam. Take up and accept whatever is pleasing to the Lord as per the directions given by the Vaishnavas, and try to reject all those things that are not pleasing, that are not favorable to our bhakti, as per the directions. Acharyas have given us everything, spoon feed karke thali mein dal ke diya hai, khali utha ke khana hai, baas.
Thank you Prabhuji. Thank you so much. I loved your beautiful example of that. You know, at the end you said like Arjuna was even not pleased with the result, but still, you know, like everyone was killed, and that was beautiful. That was very beautiful. Thank you, Prabhuji. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Jai wonderful class. Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Nitai Gaur Premanandi.
Hari Bol. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Before everyone leaves, I just wanted to make a few announcements.